Okay, thank you. And good morning, everybody. I'm very happy to see so many people wanting to hear more about open data from national mapping agencies, especially European national mapping agencies. I'm Hanna Kuus. I work in Estonian Land Board, which is a mapping agency of Estonia. And on that slide, you see some examples of our datasets, which are all openly available. By the way, I use acronym NMA to denote the National Mapping Agency, which is kind of long words to write down. So NMA is the same. And I would like to start telling you what exactly is the National Mapping Agency. Maybe you know it, but this is basically government bodies that are present in all or most countries that are responsible for national mapping programs, but not only mapping. On that slide, you can see some of the logos of European mapping agencies, and you may recognize some of those. But if you look at the names, they are very different, and from the names you can see that a lot of mapping agencies actually deal with they have other responsibilities like keeping land register, maintaining geodetical networks, keeping addresses, doing surveying or so on and so on. But in this talk, I will only focus on the mapping side and especially national mapping programs. Some of such agencies have very, very, very long history, more than 200 years in Europe. We all love all of these old, pretty maps or globes, as you see on that slide. But these traditions are still carrying on today. And the traditions are not only about like cartography, how you draw maps, but also what features are important on maps, how to prepare the mapping areas or similar things. A thing very important about national mapping agencies is that they operate on a national level. Comparing to OpenStreetMap or other community mapping programs, when you have like a community mapping, you map where you like, but mapping agencies have to do the mapping everywhere, even on like polar regions or high mountains where there are not so many volunteers usually doing the mapping. And which I find quite important is also that there's a lot of expertise in the mapping in mapping agencies because this is a full-time job for the those professional cartographers or data experts, and they are also local experts. For example, in Estonia, we do have a lot of expertise on how to present large wetlands we do have in Estonia, but of course in Switzerland they have more experts on how to map high mountains. And the expertise is not only on mapping side or on the data production, it's also some related areas. For example, national mapping agencies are maintaining national coordinate systems, which are sometimes a little bit hard to use for foreigners, but they are useful, and there still are some people who think that web mercator is not the greatest thing to have for every map. And with this expertise, which is usually the mapping agencies are government funded, there comes also responsibility and some legal requirements with quite often from outside, you can see that these agencies are slow to produce new data or not so agile as community projects. But that is because of this legal responsibility. We have to think twice or maybe even three times sometimes if we make this change or that change or if it's really necessary. But let's look at like outside view or user view also. Sometime in the past, let's say like 25 years, well, all users were happily, were very happy to use data from the mapping agencies, mostly because there were not so many national or European level datasets available. But of course, the users need to have quite a deep pockets. Data was expensive at that time. It was not open data. But during recent decades, you all know there are some new players in town. There are community mapping projects, but there are also big international companies like Google here that are very happy to get your money and bring give you some data in exchange. So as you see on the right side picture, national mapping agencies have to do something to change their processes to still stay relevant to their users. Actually, there are very many changes. I cannot cover them all. I probably don't even know about all of those changes, but I can tell you about one important change that several, especially European mapping agencies, are more and more opening up their data, offering open data, because you know open data is the next best thing since sliced bread, or at least since open source software. And it also helps to boost the economy and is good to all the users and so on and so on. But very shortly, with open data, every user can still have the benefits of the national mapping program. And it's not very related to the opening the data, but we also feel, at least in Estonian land boards, that we need to produce the data faster to be more agile because the users expect it. So this is basically the stage when we are operating today, I would say, in most of the Europe. But now I would like to move on to the data, what is available from the national mapping agencies. And well, there are a lot of data sets. I cannot cover them all. They are just a few samples. The first one is just basic geodata or basic maps, background maps, topographic maps, however you like it. Here are samples from Latvia, Switzerland, Estonia. And if I had to say just one word, I would probably choose they are different. So they look different. And if you look more closely, they are the features that they are mapping or representing are like lakes and rivers are the same, but the representation is a little bit different, which is quite fine if you want only data from one country. But if you want data from the whole Europe, for example, it's not so easy to merge all of these data sets, even if it's free data or open data. So you can still use OpenStreetMap for this pan-European projects, or I will later show you some other ways. But still, it is important because to have that kind of national data, because as I said, in remote regions or it has national coverage, you can use it like to improve also these community mapping projects or other projects you may have. Next big kind of data are the like aerial imagery, which most of European mapping agencies are producing for the whole country. Of course, nowadays you can have your own drone images done quite cheaply, but the problem is about scaling. Especially for larger countries, the national coverage is not easy at all to achieve using only drones, but mapping agencies usually operate like bigger airplanes and they cover the whole area. And as you know, with images, it's what you see is what you get. This is basically the ground truth. You can use it to improve your community maps. You can use it to train your like machine learning algorithm, whatever you like. So data is available, and I think it's really, really useful data. And the next data set is about the same. It's laser scanning point clouds. It's rather easy to collect it for a small area, but for a national coverage or larger area coverage, I don't know other sources and this data from national mapping agencies. This LiDAR point clouds, they are very, very interesting data sets. There are a lot of information inside that you can extract with very, very, very clever algorithm. But as I said, there are more and more data sets. I don't have so much time to introduce to you all of them. I don't know even all of these data sets from other countries. But I would like to move on to the next question, from what to how. How can you get this data? First thing is how can you discover it? Most of the countries have some kind of metadata portals, most often based on geo-network software, when you can actually discover or find the services. But there are also some portals, some place where you can actually download the data. And there are also built up differently. On the left-hand side, you can see Slovakian geoportal. They are building like big zip files for orthophotos. It's good if you want to download the whole country. In Estonia, on the other hand, you can only download one map tile at a time. So if you want the whole country, you have to do some scripting. So neither option is very good. It's probably better to have something different. Like in Finland, you can choose map tiles on the background map. And but still, there are different options. You have to know how to get to the data. But fortunately, not every time nowadays you don't have to download the data. You can use the services together with open data. Most often there are some relevant services for viewing the data or downloading the data. But the same problem remains. That is also for downloaded data, that maybe the data set names, attribute names are in national language or not unified. So it's hard to combine data from different countries. But there are some solutions for that problem also. One thing is Inspire. I hope that you have heard about it. I will not go very deeply. It's just a directive from European Union that says that every member country have to provide services using exactly the same data model. And the services are for very many topics or themes. So it will be, it would be possible to, it would be possible to, for example, get the buildings from all of the EU member countries using the same same data model, very similar services or road networks or whatever. There is only one problem. Inspire doesn't say that it has to be open data. So countries decide for themselves. If, for example, Estonia provides Inspire services as open data, but some countries do not. But there are other options. Another directive from European Union is called Open Data Directive, and there are accompanying legal acts defining high-value data sets. And with these high-value data sets, there is a requirement. It should be open data. It should be the metadata should be available from European data portal to be accessible and discoverable to everybody. Of course, there are, again, some gotchas with that scheme, because this directive doesn't say anything about the data models. So countries are free to change the data models or you are required to, or you get the open data, but it's again could be different from country to country. But the European data portal is it's a huge portal of metadata. You can find basically anything in that. I search for like road networks, got back something like 60,000 results. Not so good. I narrowed it down for Estonian road networks. I still got over 50 results, which is well more than expected. But the resources are there. If you are persistent, you can probably find what you need. And it's important to notice that Inspire and then this European data portal, the content is not limited to national mapping agencies, but all of this governmental or public sector data from countries. But there are some other projects as well. One project is Open Maps for Europe. This is a project of Eurogeographics. Eurogeographics is basically the umbrella organizations of all European mapping agencies. And from that project, you can have open data downloads, also open services, which are using the same data model. The data is authoritative data from member countries or member agencies. And as you can see, it's very similar output from Austria and Slovakia and other countries. So if you need like pan-European data, this is one good resource, actually. But there are other projects. I would like to draw your attention to the Location Europe project, which was initially a collaboration project between several European mapping agencies. Now it's maintained by Location Innovation Hub in Finland. And this is actually a data integration platform. It has several, it doesn't contain any data, but it redirects like original services from national mapping agencies and provides a single endpoints and is focused on this new OGC APIs, like API for features, API for coverages, and so on. So especially if you like the new RESTful standards, please go and see if you want the data. The coverage is not very good currently, but it will hopefully improve in the future. So there are, for a conclusion, there are a lot of options. And while the title of this talk was quite a provocative with a question, why? I hope I also gave some answers to what and how. So the open data is here for using, and please use it for whatever community projects, whatever you like. If you need some data from Estonian land board, it's available in the geoportal of Estonian land board. It's all open data. So you're welcome, and thank you.
Hello. Cheers, thanks a lot. This is really nice, and I, me as an Estonian, I know some parts of the land board work that what they have done, and I find it really cool that they have opened up a lot of their data sets in the past, 5 years, I think, 5-6 years, something like that. Do we have any questions? Because we have time for questions from the audience.
Thanks a lot for the talk. I just wanted to comment on the high-value data sets and maybe to clarify, to say something more, because it was just one quick slide. So high-value data sets also for the audience. This is another, comes from the Open Data Directive. The idea is to define some data sets from the public sector that have a high value, which means the potential to generate a high benefit for the economy and the society through their reuse, mainly from the private sector. So these are baseline data, a lot of geospatial data, not only geospatial. So you said there is no data model. This is partially true. There are key attributes. So like building data should have some key attributes, which doesn't mean a full data model. So it actually simplifies the requirements of Inspire, but this has to be seen as complementary to Inspire. So you correctly said in Inspire there is no requirement on the license. This comes as a kind of a top requirement. On top of Inspire, there is also the data license here, because there is almost a full overlapping in scope between the geospatial data in the high-value datasets and the Inspire data teams. And last point was on discoverability. You said, so the idea is that, of course, all open data in Europe should be discoverable in the open data portal. But there is also the Inspire geoportal. We have created a section on high-value datasets. So if you are looking for any geospatial, say, high-value dataset, just go on the Inspire geoportal because that is the place for geospatial data. In the long term, and I think in the next months, they will be also fully integrated in the open data portal. There are currently discussions on what is the metadata profile. Probably there is DCAT, geodecat somehow emerging here. We are looking for a mapping between the Inspire ISO profile and DCAT and geodecat. And including also how to filter high-value data sets so that you can more easily find it on the open data portal, which, as you said, contains a lot of other things. So I hope this was useful.
Thank you for the corrections. Of course, I had very limited time, so my main idea was just to draw your attention that there are several resources. It's good if you know about that, but of course there are a lot of details. If you start looking for the data, there are some places are better than others to use the data or some particular services.
I am running. It's a morning run. You know, it's good for you.
Thank you for the nice presentation. Some time ago there was a shift to open data, but now unfortunately we live in 2024 and the security situation in the world has changed. So how do you see these new security threats and is that still a way to opening data or something will change in the future?
Well, that's a very good question, thank you. I can say that at the moment in Estonia, everything is still open, not only geospatial data, but all other kind of open data. Of course, we have some discussions talking about like geospatial data. My personal opinion is that not very useful to hide the data that you can see from imagery, from satellites. There are so many ways to get the data. For example, from Google Maps or private satellites, even nowadays. But of course, there are some data sets that we have to be more careful with some power lines or water supply or that's. So it depends. I know that some countries have restricted some parts of their open data access recently, but I really hope that we will get out of that bad situation we have nowadays and we can bring more open data to the market because it's really a very, very great driver of innovation to my mind.
Okay. Do we have one more question? Nobody wants to ask it. Let me see if we have time.
Sorry?
Oh, yes.
It's not a question, but more a comment. I don't know whether you were at the presentation yesterday from the professor from Aalto University, because he did a really good talk on that.
It's more a comment than a question. It's, question, yes.
Yeah, thanks for the slides. My question is actually, how do you convince people at the office, you know, making this data open? Because most of the time in different countries, we are having this issue, like talking with the people from the government and always the concerns and it's so hard to explain. How did you actually kind of kick this project?
In Estonia, it was rather easy because we had to pay for our data, but the prices were rather high and we didn't earn like a lot of money. Actually, our expenses are far bigger than the money we received from the closed data. So it was quite easy to convince, and of course there are like these economic benefits and all of these bigger issues. With open data, there is like a very big movement in Estonian government sector to move towards open data everywhere in every sector.
Okay, do we have anything else? Since we have time, then I'm going to use the floor as well. I have a thing with data portals. These are really, really nice that they exist for discovering data, but sometimes, and even with the Estonian open data portal, you go there, you search for something, and data from the agency, it comes up as a web page for that specific agency. How do you deal with that? How do you manage that?
Well, I think we have here some some people who are more knowledgeable about that that portal, but it is well. I don't actually understand what is your question.
The meaning this is
you want to go to the data, not to the to the homepage or what?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Well, I know that there are some issues, some problems. Everything is not as good as we would like it to be, but probably there are some reasons that I cannot comment why exactly is it that. But if you see some issues, you know our contacts. You are very welcome to draw our attention. Sometimes there are just human errors.
Yeah, and it's not the land board; it's another Estonian agency that I was speaking about. Anybody else from the crowd? No, thank you very much. And